Okay, but please take into account I'm starting 7 minutes later. So add them at the end. Okay, thank you very much for agreeing to listen. All previous speakers simplified my task because they introduced many, quite a number of elements which I will be also be using. There will be a certain overlap, and this will probably help me to proceed further so we are not late for the reception and dinner. Okay. I will start from 1972. Of course, different speakers today started from either a later point or an earlier point, but as my lowest cutoff, I take 1972 for this simple reason that that was the year when I was accepted for a PhD program at ITEP, Institute for Theoretical and Experimental Physics in Moscow, just after defending my master's in a different institute. And I pretty well remember the development of physics beginning from the late 1972. I started my graduate program in October of 1972. Just to refresh my memory, I looked through the proceedings of the 16th International Conference on High Energy Physics, which took place almost simultaneously in September 1972 in Batavia, Illinois. And it happened so that one of the TEP theorists managed to go to, that was a rare event. At that time, we were on the different side of the Iron Curtain. But one of my colleagues went, and so he reported the results, or summarized for us the results of this conference much earlier than we would have heard about them at that time. I will briefly read the main results, the way I confirmed for reading the proceedings. So much, many talks were devoted to dual models, which, as we understand it now, they were the precursor to the string theory. Some consideration was given, not insignificant, quite significant consideration to deep inelastic scattering, Bjorken scaling, and current algebra. We heard about that from Bob. There was a discussion of E plus E minus interhadrons. Only three theorists at the conference spoke about the Weinberg-Salam model, which was a year before, was proven to be renormalizable by Gerhard Hooft. So it seems to be disproportional to the importance of the events. These speakers were Zumina, Bjorken, and Ben Lee. Ben Lee was the only person, the only theorist to refer to Hooft 1971 papers, which opened the, basically opened the gauge to a new era, opened the gates to the year, to the era of gauge theories. Also, I should mention, and also it was mentioned a little bit by Bob, that Gell-Mann was responsible for summarizing a part of the conference, well, the whole theoretical section of the conference, and he raised the question, asked himself, are quarks physical objects or abstract mathematical constructions? Then he discussed pi naught into 2 gamma decay and noted that if quarks are fermions, then the result of the experiment disagree with theoretical prediction by a factor of 3. He mentioned that this may be due to color, but didn't insist on that, or even probably doesn't mention. But what is for certain, he makes no statement of inevitability of color. That's the right, I think, characterization. So as I said, at that time I was at a very early stages of the grad school. My advisor gave me some problem to consider, and then he disappeared because he was sent for a year to build a— my advisor was Boris Yofas, just like his Arkady, but he was also a very skillful and experienced nuclear physicist, so they sent him to carry out physical design of the first Czechoslovakia nuclear power plant. So he gave me some problem, which I didn't really like, and disappeared for a year, because at that time there was no email. There was no possibility to call from our institute to foreign country, and even Czechoslovakia was considered to be a foreign country. So, but here comes Arkady from Novosibirsk, Arkady Weinstein, whom you heard, and we started talking, and he tells me, would you bother considering even this problem? Now we should all do the Weinberg-Salam model. That's the right thing to start working on. But he kept one secret. I will tell about this secret on the next page. So my first paper on ultraweak physics in the Weinberg-Salam appeared in 1973. I followed Arkady's recommendation. And then in 1974 was a revolution in physics, as also was emphasized today. And here I show a cartoon from CERN Courier, which shows the explosion of theoretical papers after November 1974, then JSI was discovered, and compared to the right, you see a very small— it's not even a peak, very small fluctuation. That was the number of experimental papers. And of course, you understand that that's the general situation, except for today, this peak of theoretical paper compared to the experimental paper in our area is even more conspicuous, you know. One goes down, the other one goes up. Okay. Next, as I said, the next stage is April 1973. I made a typo here, you see, because when I was typing this slide, I was thinking of Coleman, the previous paper which I will comment, and instead of Gross and Wilczek and Politzer, I here printed Coleman and Wilczek and Politzer. Please excuse me for this stupid mistake. I noted it earlier today, but it was too late to change. So here comes April 72, but I return first, you know, in general, in Soviet Union, we had a special feature. Everything, all information which was coming from the West was coming with a certain delay, a rather long delay. That's because all literature coming from the West has to be checked by higher authorities. So sometimes this check would take a little time, sometimes it could be a few months. So as long as I remember, in fact, the other paper of Gross and Coleman, which you see at the very top, July 73, came to our ETAP library first, not the April 73 papers, but the next one. And it was devoted to their search of possible asymptotically free field theories among all possible field theories. The statement is no renormalizable field theory that consisted of theories with arbitrary Yukawa, scalar, or abelian gauge interactions could be asymptotically free. Well, I remember that I thought at that time, why publish a paper? Everybody knows that. Because in the Landau circle, in fact, when Landau found the Landau zero in QED, he asked his students to check all other theories. And indeed, as Arkady mentioned, the general knowledge was that in all field theories, you can relate the charge renormalization to the imaginary part of the corresponding graph. And the students, Landau students, checked all possible theories, which included all those mentioned by David. And they came to the conclusion that none of them is asymptotically free. All of them are infrared free and lead to the Landau behavior. Okay. And here I am telling you about this secret, which Arkady Weinstein kind of forgot to mention to me when he came a year before that. He already mentioned about the work of Kriplovich, which was published in 1969, which showed that the calculation of the corresponding Z factor in Young-Mills theory produces asymptotic freedom, despite the fact that this does not invalidate the statement that positive imaginary part of the Feynman graph produces infrared freedom. The point is, which was seen from Kriplovich calculation, that it's only the diagram which doesn't have imaginary part in this gauge which produces asymptotic freedom. And indeed, today we know that there are only, among bosonic theories, there are only two exceptions, Young-Mills and sigma models in two dimensions, which this latter one has a tadpole contribution, which is responsible, which doesn't have imaginary part at all. And in the abelian theory, in the non-abelian four-dimensional theory, that's a graph where a Coulomb quantum is exchanged. So that was one of the consequences of the Iron Curtain but it's a side remark. So here is a quotation from not Coleman and Wilczek, by Gross and Wilczek. Well, it's recollections by David Cross, published later. We completed the calculation for Young-Mills theory in a spurt of activity. At one point, a sign error in one of the term convinced us that Young-Mills theory was, as expected, not asymptotically free. As I sat down to put it together and to write up our results, I caught the error. At almost the same time, Politzer finished his calculation and we compared through Sidney Coleman our results. The agreement was satisfying. So that was the moment where the gates were open. Unfortunately, I was pretty in time, you see. I came to this science, to this new roads in high energy physics, almost at the right time. Okay, next. One of the things which have only marginally mentioned here today, I think it was by Bob. He was the only one who mentioned operator product expansion. I think we should give great credit to Ken Wilson, who in 1969 summarized in a PhysRef paper, summarized his vision of the operator product expansion. And I should say that in this paper, if you look really at it, the problem of delta I equal to 2 to 1/2 was discussed. He couldn't calculate anything because he didn't have a theory at hand, a particular theory at hand in order to calculate. But he made a statement that when we do the operator product expansion for k to 2 pi and k to 3 pi decays, it may well be that the operator product expansion produces a different different contributions for this for the corresponding operators. Also, he not just wrote, it was not a technical paper. It was a vision of the whole thing, which changed how we compared to, which changed the whole idea. He said, let's start from short distances and then evolve the theory down step by step. He even mentions this condensed matter ideas of doubling the number of plaquettes. And then each time we calculate a new Lagrangian, and then we make another step, we make another step, and so on. In 1972, of course, operator product expansion was kind of was known to people who did theorists who were interested in deep and elastic scattering. But that was not really the Wilson expansion, because they didn't, they missed the step of evolving the theory down step by step. And all calculations in deep and elastic scattering in 1972 were done only perturbative coefficients were calculated, only the leading twist operators were included, and they were all very standard quark operators. No, people made no effort to calculate subleading twist or gluon operators. In which sense, in this sense, when we started working on our first work with Arkady and Zakharov was, one of the first, maybe not exactly the first, was this addressing this problem of delta I equal to 2 to 1/2. And there are peculiarities. You see, compared to Wilson's general strategy, there are peculiarities. Because in QCD, ultraviolet fixed point is at alpha s equal to 0. Usually, in condensed matter, is at not vanishing alpha s, and therefore approach to the fixed point is power-like. In QCD, it's logarithmic approach, because when alpha s equal to 0, when you integrate the RG equation, you get only logarithmic. And it's a very slow approach. So basically, in QCD, we cannot just take the asymptotic results for, say, anomalous dimensions or any values at the fixed point. It's the approach to fixed point which we need to calculate. Another thing special for QCD is that the scale lambda, dynamical scale, is not unique, which have to be taken into account. Heavy quark masses also play a role, an important role in a range of phenomena, which was also not discussed at that time. And at least, we realized that at least we have to go beyond perturbation theory, at least some information from the infrared should be known. Of course, at that time, we couldn't even imagine that the lattice calculation will, well, it was even before the onset, it was, what, it was 73, right? So the first lattice calculation were suggested by Michael was 79, and they reached reasonable reasonable accuracy, as we heard, only by the year 2000, especially with the chiral quarks. But we understood that the need for some infrared information, and we started started adjusting Wilson's idea for operator product expansion in the form it was known before us. So we included all three points Here I repeat that 1973 or 74, I don't remember exactly, Vali Zakharov, Arkady Weinstein and myself starting doing this. And when we first started thinking about delta I equal 1/2, we pretty quickly realized that we need operator with the gluon. It's quark gluon operator. That was the first operator which was introduced into the problem, which was not only built from quarks. So with regards to quarks, we have the equation of motion, d nu, g mu nu. It produces the quark current again. So formally, it's a four fermion operator, but the chiral structure is totally different. It's not left, 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 left. It's left, left, right, right. And this led to dramatic consequences. So here I summarize the table of operators. Almost all of them we were the first to introduce. But the first one was introduced by Gell-Mann, Oakes, and Renner. This is an obvious operator which measures the chiral symmetry breaking, Q bar Q. Chiral symmetry, this scalar density breaks SU3 cross SU3 down to SU3 and predicts the existence of massless pions. So we knew already beforehand that this operator has its lowest dimension and it has also non-vanishing vacuum expectation value. Now we introduced the gluon condensate, the mixed condensate, the four quark condensate, and even marginally discussed the three gluon condensate. With condensate containing quark pair Q by Q, it's obvious because it's easy because they break the chiral symmetry, so in perturbation theory, their value should be zero. They cannot be non-vanishing in perturbation theory. With the gluon condensate, we assumed that it has a vacuum expectation value, and we would be asked frequently that it doesn't break, obviously, or seemingly doesn't break any symmetry. Why should you speak about this? This is not another parameter. Why you should speak? I explain a little bit later what does it mean in the context of the Wilson's operator product expansion. So then we raised a question of what can be said about the static properties of the low line or classical hadronic resonances. Classical not the mean that they are not quantum, but in the meaning that they are so very well studied, so experimentally, so there is no doubt about the mass values and coupling constant values. To consider this, we basically used the standard technique, more or less standard for that time. We considered the we started with two-point function of various sources. Vector current, for instance, for O-meson or omega-meson, or tensor current for tensor-meson. And then we tried to calculate as good as we can this correlator function in the Euclidean domain, not only perturbation theory, which was of course a trivial task, but also including all these condensates into consideration. So the first of course effect was from Q bar Q. It entered, always enters in the form M Q, Q bar Q, so it dimension 4. The gluon operator G squared is also dimension 4. Next comes is dimension 6 and another dimension, and another couple of operators of dimension 6. So we included them on the left-hand side, so to say theoretical for this function. And on the right, you see here the generic form, where it is, what we obtained. Here you see the letter mu, which I will explain momentarily. And on the right-hand side, we saturated by resonances. Resonances are a continuum contribution. So every resonance is characterized by two parameters, the coupling constant by its mass, and then continuum contribution in principle. You could have continue with resonance parameterization, but with approximate nature of calculation of the theoretical size, if you have too many parameters, unknown parameters, you can fit whatever you want. It's uncertain. So we try to substitute, instead of what is written here as excitation, we try to because its contribution was supposed to be small, we try to approximate it by a continuum contribution, which more or less similar to just quark and gluon contribution, starting from some threshold S sub naught, S sub zero. So there were three parameters to be fitted by the left-hand side, by what we calculate for the left-hand side. This is some artistic idea of how the vacuum medium should look like. This kind of a joke. I just show you and go further on. So now we had enough, as I mentioned, we have the task. Our calculation was admittedly approximate. We only have included operators up to dimension 6. And the convergence, I should tell you that the convergence in 1 over q squared was not very fast. And moreover, now we know that the series in 1 over q squared, it's asymptotic series. It's not convergent. If you go too far, it's not convergent at all. So that's one point. It has some exponentially small corrections. As any asymptotic series, if you cut it off somewhere, you have exponential corrections to it, right? But if you take exponential corrections and from Euclidean transfer them to Minkowski, you obviously get exponent e to the power minus, let's say, q squared, e to the power minus q produces oscillations whose amplitude falls off only as a power, certain power of energy. Okay? So we needed to suppress this bad convergence to make convergence better and also to enhance the ground state resonance, to suppress the continuum to make its contribution smaller. And we figured out that if we do Borel procedure, what is the Borel procedure in the case at hand? You see it from here. This is the resonance contribution. If you do the Borel procedure, the way then you expand it, you have an expansion in m squared over q squared, and then Borel procedure introduces n factorial in front of the nth power. And then instead of this weight function, which falls off but not fast enough, you get an exponential wave function, e to the power minus mi over q squared. So both theoretically, lowest order, lowest dimension condensate got enhanced, and also experimentally, the unwanted tail of the continuum contribution got suppressed. Okay. Alternatively, instead of doing Borelization, one could do operator product expansion in the coordinate space. Instead of momentum space, you use small x, small distance. Then, of course, there is kind of Borelization because, but instead of exponent with q squared in the exponent, you have the first power of distance. You see, you have a McDonald's function here. It's better than the resonance in the momentum space, better than the power behavior, but not as good as Borealization. Okay. Probably, you see, I won't give you tables here, because by today, our tables cannot be compared to what lattice people did. But I remind you, that was mid to late 70s, before everything. But we got a beautiful overall agreement up to our accuracy, which we estimated to be 10 to 15%. With all the spectrum of low-lying resonances, both bosonic and baryonic, with one noticeable exception. This exception was the channel with the quantum numbers zero spin and parity plus or minus. That's the pi eta eta prime channel and glue-ball channels, okay? So in these channels, even applying Borel procedure, we didn't manage to suppress strongly enough the higher dimension operators, and we didn't have much of a success in this channel. The only general thing which we discovered was the existence in this channel. So we figured out that in this channel, the normal hadronic scale is larger than in all other channels. Like in vector channel, the hadronic scale is m rho, which is 0.75 GeV. In baryonic, it's mass of the proton, which is 1 GeV. Here, our analysis indicated to the existence of the scale of maybe 2.5 or 3 GeV. So our sum rules don't really work in the quantitative sense in this zero plus minus channel, but qualitatively it produces a hint. Now I will explain you things about why the gluon operator should be present. We know that there are graphs which are called Renormalons. Okay, it is one of them is depicted here. You see, it's a bubble chain in the gluon operator, in the gluon propagator. This bubble chain, if you start calculating it perturbatively, it produces alpha s series, which is divergent at large orders. It contains n factorial. You see here at large n, you get n factorials. It's, of course, an artifact of using perturbative approximation. Why n factorial appears? Because with too many bubbles, even if you start with large momenta external, then with more and more bubbles, the characteristic momentum flowing in this propagator becomes smaller and smaller, and then you hit the strong interaction and the pole. But this is not, it was clear that was going to happen, but it's not in the spirit of Wilson operator product expansion. Because in Wilson operator product expansion, when we do this evolution, we have to introduce scale and say, okay, there is a scale mu, and every operator, very coefficient, depends on scale mu. And from mu and upwards, larger momentum, they're included in coefficients. And from mu to downwards, in the soft direction, these are the operators in this expansion, because this is a strong interaction. So in fact, what happens if you start thinking these factorials, after introducing mu, let's say 2 or 3 lambda QCD, all these factorials disappear at large orders, but then you have to insert a gluon operator for soft contribution. The dimensions match. So now we know, at that time when our paper was written in 78, we didn't think of it, although there is some consideration on that, but it was only realized later. And this is another plot I present here, which demonstrates the fact when you do calculations, which has still to be, it's still not solved. In many places, in many, many problems, we need the prediction not in Euclidean, but in Minkowski. For instance, when we calculate the hadronic decays of heavy mesons, okay? It's very, let's say, B meson. It's very far from Euclidean. You have to have, if you want to extract it from inclusive hadronic width, let's say for a B, even for C meson, you have to calculate in the Euclidean with the exponential accuracy, because extremely suppressed exponent, when you start analytically continuing it in Minkowski, it loses its suppression. You see, here is a plot which I obtained in different model, which illustrates this problem, okay? This is the plot which we have in the spectral density for the raw meson channel, and there is a very conspicuous first peak, a little bit visible second peak, and then very after second peak, you have almost a smooth curve, which is here indicated by dotted line, but still oscillating. It's either below or upwards. And the amplitude of oscillation goes down as some power of E, which is model dependent. In some models, it's maybe E squared, in other models, maybe E to the power 3/2, 1 over E to the power 3/2, and so on. So unless you go very, very far away, well, let's say inclusive Z mesons, when they decay into hadrons, probably already this oscillating contribution is already not important. But for all hadronic decays, they're very still important. Now let me qualitatively explain how this is obtained theoretically, because there is some theoretical idea, not very precise, but you can obtain it. Let's say we go first to n equal to infinity, infinite number of colors. Then all peaks become delta functions. You have a combo of delta functions, and in between them, if you make a quark gluon prediction, you are 100% off. Or 1000% off, I don't know, very much off. And exactly at the peak, if you'd even average it, you are again off, unless you average over a large interval. The same picture is obtained if I use quasi-classical string-like picture. So I say, like today it was discussed, you have U plus or minus at high energy, it produces a pair of quark anti-quark. Let's say I start from large but finite n, then large but finite n, we still have a visible quarks. But when you go to high excitation, the width of the quark grows with the number of excitations for fixed n. So here it is important. You have two parameters, n capital, which is the number of colors, and n small, which is the number of excitation. If you first put n capital equal to infinity from the very beginning, you will still have a comb lasting to infinity. If you first put n, the number of colors, finite, but n small, large, then this will be totally smeared because the distance between the resonances will become smaller than the width of the resonances. They are a very nice quasi-classical picture, which you can obtain in this way. If you have a resonance of with number n, its width is mn, its mass multiplied by its width, and the width itself is proportional to mn, but divided by nc. It's obvious that it has to be divided by nc, and this is some coefficient which could be even, at least in the given channel, could be universal. You can estimate it from, let's say, Rho meson, and it's pretty small. It's not order, it's not one, as could have been expected. It's something like 0.2. So now if you draw this picture, and if you sum all the combo of equidistant resonances, but now with the widths, it's doable analytically, and what you get for the imaginary part is depicted here. So you know the relative widths, you know the relative height of this peak and of this peak and all subsequent. They decrease as a power. And the proof of this formula that gamma is proportional to mass divided by nc, it's pretty trivial. It's because the length of the quasi-classics, the length of the string goes as mass, right? The mass is the energy, so for high energies, the L is proportional to the mass. And the probability of decay of a piece of a string of size 1 in natural units is 1 over nc in the units of lambda. So you take L, which is divided by nc, and the natural units L is not in the natural, L is mn times lambda minus 2. So it's a quasi-classically trivial formula. Okay, I should hear, I have like 11 plus 7, 18 minutes. Okay, I should hear. Okay, a little less than that. I should emphasize here that given all its limitation and limited accuracy, SVZ is not just another approximate model. It's not a model at all, you know? And as illustration, I will remind you the story which happens in 1977 when experiment discovered the so-called state X283, which was pronounced to be para-charmonium, you know, zero minus charmonium state. And the mass difference between J psi experimentally and this 283 state was 270 MeV. Now we try to obtain this larger mass difference in the sum rule and tried very hard, but it turned out to be impossible. The absolute maximum, if all errors are put in one direction, we could obtain only around close to 100 MeV. So at that time, people started writing papers, theorists. You remember the cartoon on the first slide, a lot of papers that X283 is indeed para-charmonium, and our paper was probably the only one who said that's not possible. And so indeed, in 1979, 2 years later, the experiment for 283 was retracted, and the new experiment produced the result 298 plus or minus 0.01. In full agreement what the sum rules produced. Okay. Now that's all. about this SVZ sum rule. The only thing which I should say today, of course, they cannot compete with the lattice calculation with one exception. If you need to obtain something which requires a long analytic continuation from Euclidean, where all lattice calculations are done, to Minkowski, okay? And I will proceed to the second topic, which I will cover. It's the heavy quark expansion, which was developed by Misha Voloshin, Kolya Uraltsev, Arkady Weinstein, and myself. But I will start from 1980s, where only Ivan and Misha Voloshin were doing it, and tell you a short story about it. So at that time, it was not even mid-80s, it was early 80s, 82, I believe, we started thinking about non-perturbative effects in the heavy quark decays, hadronic decays. And we, at that time, the only way to calculate was calculating in terms of free quarks. But I realized very quickly that it's not, cannot be true, because you have, let's say, d anti-quark in the final state, and d anti-quark is produced in the weak decay. There should be destructive interference between their this contribution, because a part of the phase space is already taken by the spectator anti-d quark. You cannot produce in the decay another d quark which belongs to the same part of the phase space. The question was how to figure it out, how to obtained quantitative result, not just qualitative, but quantitative result. So one day we very quickly draw this relevant diagram responsible for interference. Here upwards you see the diagram which with three quarks, and D is a spectator not connected to the decaying quark. And then another diagram, which where you see you exchange just the position of the produced and existing before the decay d quark. So you get this graph. You see, you exchange them. This d quark no longer becomes just totally decoupled, and this. Now, if C is large enough, and if you do, of course, it's a Minkowski calculation, but you can say, okay, for large energies, you can calculate this coefficient. It will have imaginary part that because it's in the Minkowski, but to some accuracy, this should be a valid calculation. So we calculated the interference between the upper graph and the lower graph. And published it. I published, Misha somehow was busy with something else. I was writing at that time a report about heavy quarks, and I put these diagrams and the result of our calculation with the report with the reference for Voloshin-Shiffman unpublished. And then I was already deeply immersed into the calculation of into supersymmetry, exact beta functions and so on. So more or less, I forgot it for a couple of years. And in a couple of years, all of a sudden, I'm getting a call, international. The only office in our building which was authorized to receive international call was the so-called international office, which was, of course, hiddenly, it was a branch of KGB. So they summoned me. They were in awe, because this was a very rare event, but okay, this was a call from Yugoslavia, then it existed, and so, but Yugoslavia was considered to be a capitalist country by Soviet consideration, so it was very much of ordinary. And it was Branka Guberina in Nevin Bilic from Croatia who called me. Bilic knew Russian, so he said, look, we read your review recently. and found this contribution of the interference, and they fully agree, but except the sign. Interference should produce the negative sign because it effect of diminishing the space. So, okay, I met with Misha Voloshin. We rechecked the sign quickly, and indeed we missed a sign. I don't even remember at which stage we missed a sign. But when we decided to make a systematic analysis of all weak decays of heavy mesons and baryons along these lines. And we did it and published two papers in 1985 and 1986. One for C-containing heavy mesons and one for B-containing heavy mesons. At that time, this was basically just a prediction, because very few decays of the C-containing and B-containing mesons were measured well enough, and none of the baryons, okay? Here is the expansion, which we wrote. So when you get a coefficient in the expansion in this time, it has the imaginary part. And gamma, the decay width, is proportional to the imaginary part. Later, this approach, which we used, it's the expansion in the inverse mass of the heavy quarks. In the late 80s, it was kind of reformulated under the name of HQET by Georgia, Greenstein, and who else? Who was the third author? CGJ, yes, C. C was I forgot his name. It's hard for me to pronounce. I forgot it. Never mind. I can tell you later. But somehow we didn't like it. We continued to work in this direction till probably late 1990s, and we didn't like this shortcut through HQET. Now I will show you what happened. In the mid-80s, we predicted the ratio of lambda b to, with Misha Voloshin, to b sub d, lambda sub b to b sub d. We predicted it to be 0.9 plus or minus 0.03. Now, 10 years later, in the late 7 years later, it was measured to be 0.77 plus or minus 0.05. So it was many, many error bars beyond. Disagreement was many, many error bars. But we stood firmly, and in the late 2010, so another 20 months later, it was remeasured by a couple of groups. It turned out to be 0.93 plus or minus 0.05. We didn't even expect this kind of accuracy. We expect that it maybe will be a few percent off, you know, let's say at least one standard deviation or it's off, but it's right in the middle. Okay, now I'm almost finishing. This problem my last. Now, continuing, I will summarize the situation with the baryons. You see here the experimental results for the measuring of mesons and baryons. Mesons are to the left, and baryons are to the right. This is results of many average results of a number of group, LHCb, Bell 2, and so on. Okay, I want to draw your attention to this disagreement. This is the result, I forgot which of, one point is the result reported in Particle Data Group 2018, and another point is the result which was obtained recently in Bell, and there the discrepancy between these two results for one and the same quantity, the decay of omega sub c, is many, many standard deviation from each other. Okay? Now we start looking for our with Misha Voloshin prediction of 1986. This with long arrow bars is our result in 1986. And the pink point is this recent measurements of Bell. You see, experiment again was off by many standard deviation, but our theoretical prediction, although with sick work it's even worse, because sick work mass is 1.25 GeV. So the expansion over the sick work mass is not so good, but a priori, it cannot be too good. So the fact that we put a large arrow bar is not surprising. Okay, do I have anything else? Doesn't want me to speak. Did you switch? Did it switch off? I just have my summary on the last page. If you go, it's the last but one, probably.
It doesn't work?
No.
Oh, it's working on this one. That's the problem. Am I supposed to? Yeah, he can help. Yeah. So it's like on the wrong thing. He pushes the button.
Is that the next one?
Yeah, that's my, but go further. This I have no time. Okay. I want to conclude my talk with this last summary. Well, the consequences of what I said, now these are called OPE-based methods in strong coupling in QCD, and they did what they could. They provided certain amount of qualitative differences, qualitative insight, and some kind of subsequent development still exist. People still use expanded sum rules in the form of the so-called light cone sum rules if they need the prediction for something, like for instance a form factor at large momentum transfer, okay? So they still use it. We use the insights as good as hard as good as we can, but now this is my conjecture. I don't know whether it's wrong or true. If somebody asks me whether QCD in all its entirety, in all its complexity, will be ever analytically solved. I remember many promises that this will happen from many very respectable people, and it never happened during 50 years of existence of QCD. And the reason is clear, because QCD is very versatile, very diverse theory. It covers many energy intervals. It covers hard and soft processes, interference between these processes. So the approach to the fixed point is only logarithmic. It's only, but anywhere, even though it's logarithmic, even though there is UV fixed point, somewhere there is the domain of soft physics. And there, as you see from this list, this domain covers all of nuclear physics, Reggio behavior, soft and hard dynamics overlap, quark gluon matter, high T, high mu, neutron stars, which also were measured today. All richness of the hadronic world, including the zero plus or minus channel, which I have mentioned, and which indeed we know now has its own specific, with eta prime related very much to the soft physics. chiral physics, global and exotic exclusive and inclusive phenomena, interplay between strong forces and weak interactions, finally highly excited states and their decays. So I don't think that there can be analytic theory which is suitable, not qualitatively, but suitable quantitatively for the description of all these various aspects of real life QCD. Although certain aspects are indeed developed very much. And here I should say, concluding my talk, that starting from late 80s, a great help in analytic understanding of QCD came from the supersymmetric gauge theories, like super Young-Mills or super QCD. The first exact results were obtained in the 80s. There was a number of like exact beta function calculation, exact calculation of the Gliina condensate and so on. But a real breakthrough occurred in 99 with the Zyberg-Witten solution of n equal 2, which demonstrated at least in the low energy limit and also in the limit where abelization takes place, that there indeed there is a string which develops between heavy quark and heavy anti-quark, which are probe objects. But if at low energy limit of n equal to super Young-Mills, there is an Abrikosov-Nielsen-Olesen string between them, which precludes free travel of quarks, anti-quarks. They're permanently confined to each other. And since then, there were many more results which really help us, at least in the qualitative sense, to go ahead with the understanding of real-world QCD. Thank you very much.